Now let's examine the performance considerations of caching. So we'll start by talking about the three different kinds of cache misses. These are sometimes called the three C's. So the first kind of miss is a compulsory or a cold miss. And this is just because we've just started the machine and there's actually nothing in the cache. And so we'll need to load every new value that we access initially. And as this happens, we say that the cache is becoming warmed up and the values are being stored and loaded in from the lower levels. Once we have some data in the cache, we might start having conflict misses, where we have a cache miss due to there being multiple lines in our working set, which is the the set of all data that we're trying to work with at any given time. And if multiple addresses in that set map to the same cache line, then we're going to have conflict misses because we're going to load one and then we're going to need the other. If this happens over and over and over again and we keep repeatedly having to get rid of one of them, this is called thrashing. And then finally, there is a capacity miss, which just refers to the situation where you have too many things that you're trying to work with at any given time, and you just can't fit them all into cache. And so you're going to have misses just because you can't get everything into the cache. All right, so once the cache set is full, a miss in that set is going to require some of those lines to be replaced or evicted. There are a bunch of policies for this, aside from just kind of picking one, like picking the least recently used or the least frequently used. However, some of these policies require additional overhead, which can be a bad thing, especially for certain levels of the memory hierarchy. So we also need to think a little bit about how to handle writes. There are two main policies for this. There's write through, where if you have a write to something that's in cache, you immediately update the lower level. This is typically used for the higher levels of the hierarchy. Or you could do what's called write back, and you could defer that write until that line is evicted from the cache. And this is typically used for lower levels of the memory hierarchy. We should also think about how we want to handle write misses. So we're trying to write to something that has not been loaded into the cache. So again, there are two policies here. So there's something called write allocate, which loads the line and then does the update. And this is typically used for write back caches. And then there's also no write allocate, which does the update down to the lower level without loading it into the cache. And this is typically used for write through caches. All right, so what are the metrics that we use to measure our cache's performance? So one major one is the hit rate or the hit ratio. This is simply the number of hits divided by the total number of memory accesses. And we could also define a miss rate or miss ratio, and these are just you take one and you subtract it from one to get the other. We also define the hit time as being the delay in accessing data for a cache hit. We could also define a miss time similarly. And so like I said, the miss rate or the miss ratio is the number of misses divided by the total number of memory accesses. The read throughput or the bandwidth is the rate at which a program reads data from the memory system. And so we have some general observations here, which is so if you have a larger cache, you're going to have a higher hit rate because you can fit more things in it. But you're also going to have a higher hit time because it's going to take a little bit longer to search the cache to see whether something is in there or to retrieve that value. If we have lower miss rates, which is what we're going for, we're going to have higher read throughput because we're going to be able to use our higher levels of the memory hierarchy. So the book walks you through a little case study here and shows you six different versions of the same matrix multiply code. And the specifics are not important here. The important thing to note is that these all do the exact same thing in the sense that the end result is the same. You get the same answer. However, you have different kinds of access patterns on the data that you're manipulating. And because of the way that caching impacts performance, these different methods, these different implementations of the matrix multiply actually have significantly different performance characteristics. So on this graph, lower is better. And again, this is a logarithmic axis over here on the right with the cycles per inner loop iteration. And so you can see that some of these implementations are significantly faster than others. And this is why we need to be aware of these things, because we could be leaving significant amounts of performance on the table if we don't optimize our programs to take advantage of the caching system. So, general optimization strategies. Focus on the common cases. Focus on the code regions that dominate the runtime. Focus on inner loops, because those are the ones that are getting executed the most. And try to minimize cache misses during those inner loops. Favor repeated local accesses, so try to access the same things over and over again. This improves your program's temporal locality. And try to favor stride one access patterns as much as possible in order to take advantage of spatial locality. There is a tool called Valgrim that we've been using to do memory leak checks all semester. It can also detect cache misses, so you can look up a tool called Cache Grind to see how to use that tool. Okay, so back to core themes that we've talked about here. So the cache design system involves trade-offs, as have many of the other systems we've talked about. So one trade-off is larger caches, which will lead to a higher hit rate, but also a higher hit time. You could choose to build a cache system with larger blocks, which would give you a higher hit rate for programs that have good spatial locality, but this would give you a lower hit rate for other kinds of programs. You could build caches with higher associativity, which will give you a lower chance of thrashing because you store more lines per set, but this is going to be more expensive to implement in the hardware, and it could possibly increase the hit time. And of course, doing more writes is going to be simpler to implement, but could give you lower performance rather than, you know, buffering them and doing them later. Okay, so that wraps up our discussion, mostly of caching, aside from a couple of examples. And so our next topic is actually a specific kind of cache called virtual memory. This is an operating system level memory cache, and it actually serves as a very nice bridge between Module 4, which is about the hardware, and Module 5, which is about the software. And so this is going to be an example of a software level system for basically caching pieces of memory.